promises you're there. When I lift my voice, sorrow traded for freedom, for love, for you. Even through my pain, I will lift my voice and say, my hope is alive.
Happy Resurrection Sunday. We're so excited to worship with you today via online. We love you. We miss you. We're going to take this opportunity to do communion in our home. This is so important for daddies and mamas to be together with your kids. And if you're a single adult, for yourself, making this time special in your house, a very solemn time, a time of remembrance, a time of thinking about the sacrifice that Jesus made for us, the blood that covers us. It's so powerful. It's such a beautiful moment. And to bring this into our home is so special. Go ahead and get your items that you have collected to start communion in your home, whatever it is, whatever you have on hand. Get the family. Let's come together for a time of prayer.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you.
Lord, I pray for you.
Thank you for this day. This is the day that you have made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. Thank you, Father, for the opportunity to still serve you on this very unconventional Easter Sunday that we're having right now. But Father, you knew that this day would come. You knew that it would unfold like it is unfolding right now, that we wouldn't be able to collectively be together in the physical church house, but we are the church of the living God, and gathered in our homes and gathered with our family members and gathered most of all with you, Lord Jesus. We are united in the Spirit. And so we join our hearts and our minds and our spirits together right now as we get ready to partake of the body of Jesus Christ and the blood of Jesus Christ, remembering the sacrifice that you made for us. We thank you, Father. We thank you, Father, that that tomb is still empty to this day. We thank you for the sacrifice that you made for us and the bridge that you built to bring humanity back to yourself. We give you all of the glory, all of the praise, and all of the honor. And I pray your blessing on every family, on every individual today. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, amen and amen. All right, if you would take a hold of your bread or your cracker, whatever it is that you are using today, The Bible says, as oft as you do this in remembrance of me. The Lord Jesus made the ultimate sacrifice. The blood of the Lamb slain from the foundations of the world, the breaking of his body was for you and I, so that we could be reconciled to him. And so I want everyone to partake right now of the breaking of the body of the Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. All right, if you would get ready to partake of the blood of Jesus Christ, remembering that precious blood that was shed on Calvary, that has buried our sins. Our sins, if you've been buried in the name of Jesus, your sins are buried underneath that blood that was shed. Let's partake of the blood of Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Father, right now, I pray that in every home, the Spirit of God is flooding into those homes right now. That husbands and wives and single parents and children right now, grandchildren, are feeling the presence and the power of Almighty God. Lord Jesus, you broke so many of the customs and the religious traditions during the days of your flesh. You healed on the Sabbath. Your disciples ate on the Sabbath, God. You were called a Sabbath buster. And today, Lord God, you are an Easter buster, Lord God. You have broken the tradition of Easter, Lord God, that has reigned for so long. But right now, Lord Jesus, families are calling on the name of the Lord. And we are still partaking of the body and the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you, Father. We do this in remembrance of you. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen and amen and amen. Thank you, Jesus.
Oh, It's Friday. Jesus is praying. Peter is asleep. Judas is betraying. But Sunday's coming. It's Friday. Pilate's struggling. The council is conspiring. The crowd is vilifying. They don't even know that Sunday's coming. It's Friday. The disciples are running like sheep without a shepherd. Mary's crying. Peter is denying. But they don't know that Sundays are coming. It's Friday. The Romans beat my Jesus. They robe him in scar. They crown him with thorns. But they don't know that Sunday's coming. It's Friday. See Jesus walking to Calvary. His blood dripping. His body stumbling. And his spirit's burdened. But you see, it's only Friday. Sunday's coming. It's Friday. The world's winning. People are sinning. And evil's grinning. It's Friday. The soldiers nailed my Savior's hands to the cross. They nailed my Savior's feet to the cross. And then they raised him up next to criminals. It's Friday. But let me tell you something. Sunday's coming. It's Friday. The disciples are questioning what has happened to their king. And the Pharisees are celebrating that their scheming has been achieved. But they don't know. It's only Friday. Sunday's coming. It's Friday. He's hanging on the cross, feeling forsaken by his Father, left alone and dying. Can nobody save him? Oh, it's Friday, but Sunday's coming. It's Friday, the earth trembles, the sky grows dark, my king yields his spirit. It's Friday, hope is lost, death has won, sin has conquered, and Satan's just a laugh. It's Friday. Jesus is buried. A soldier stands guard, and a rock is rolled into place. But it's Friday. It is only Friday. Sunday is a coming.
You call my name.
Tradition of gathering in buildings for Easter Sunday and having a grand old time, everybody dressing up in their finest, and Easter egg hunts and all that stuff is not happening today. All over the world it is not happening today, but guess what, the Easter egg hunt's not going to happen, and we're not going to gather inside of our buildings today, but we definitely are gathering today to still remember the day that Jesus Christ resurrected himself from the grave. Amen and amen. So I'm going to preach with the help of the Holy Ghost today, Resurrection Day 2020. Resurrection Day 2020. Very challenging times, but exciting times. I am excited. God is excited because the church, the people of God, are repenting. They're doing exactly what the Word of God tells us to do, and God is hearing us from heaven, and healing is already on its way. Somebody agree with me today that healing is already on its way, in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Let me read for you today out of Mark chapter 16. I'm going to read 6 verses of Scripture here, and I am reading out of the New Living Translation for you. Saturday evening, when the Sabbath ended, Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James, and Salome went out and purchased burial spices so they could anoint Jesus' body. Very early on Sunday morning, just at sunrise, they went to the tomb. On the way, they were asking each other, "Who will roll away the stone for us from the entrance of the tomb?" Little did they know, an angel had already taken care of that job. But as they arrived, they looked up and saw that the stone, which was very large, had already been rolled aside. Somebody say, it's already been rolled aside. When they entered the tomb, they saw a young man clothed in a white robe sitting on the right side. The women were shocked. But the angel said, "Don't be alarmed. You are looking for Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He isn't here. He is risen from the dead. Look, this is where they laid his body." Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I pray that the anointed word of God, the forever settled word of God, right now is going into everybody's hearts, going into their minds, digging down deep into their spirits. And that today, Lord God, transformation is going to take place after the preached word of God, during the preached word of God. And somebody today is going to happen upon their resurrection today. I say all of this in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And sitting in your home today, shout amen. So we have the story here of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. The very first people
that came to find that Jesus had in fact risen from the dead. A small group, a small gathering of women had made up their mind that they were going to make a purchase of some spices. They were going to go very early Sunday morning, and they were going to anoint the dead body of their Savior. On the way, they began to talk about, how are we going to get that heavy stone rolled away from the mouth of that tomb so we can actually get to the dead body that is inside? All the while, from what we read in the scripture, I don't read any shred of faith on their part. I don't read where they began to converse about, perhaps he is risen like he said he would. They had a made up mind that they were going to find a very dead body after 3 days, and they were going to anoint that dead body with the spices that they had purchased with their own money. I thank God for their action. I thank God for their purchase. I thank God for skin in the game. But I wish to God that somebody on that trip would have had some faith to believe that we don't have to worry about the stone, because no stone has been able to keep him yet. No stone has been able to hold him back. And this one couldn't either, because when they got there, he was already gone. The angel of the Lord had already rolled it aside. They were looking for something dead, but they happened to be looking amongst the living. Why seek you the living amongst the dead? You're looking for something that isn't here. He was dead, but he's alive, and he's alive forevermore. If you're thankful for the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ, give the Lord a hand clap of praise. Come on, right in your living room right now, wherever you're watching this, begin to clap your hands and applaud the Lord Jesus Christ for doing something that no other man has been able to do and that never will be able to do. He orchestrated his own resurrection. He got up out of the grave all by himself. That's something to applaud. We applaud football games. We applaud other athletic events. We applaud politicians. We applaud our children when they do things great. And we applaud all kinds of things. Don't you forget to applaud the one that rose back from the dead for you. Give him some applause today. Give him some praise with your hands. Acts 4:33 says this, and with great power gave the apostles witness of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus. And great grace was upon them all. I want to break this scripture down for you just a little bit today. Three different words that I'm going to pull out of here, and I am going to break them down a little bit into the Greek. The word power, the word witness, and the word resurrection. The word power in the Greek is pronounced dunamis. It means power residing in a thing by virtue of its nature. Now, I could stop right there and I could preach for a minute. Power residing in a thing by virtue of its nature. But let me go on. I'll get to it in a minute. Power, it goes on to define power for performing miracles. Are you listening to me, body of Christ, today? Are you hearing me, men? Are you hearing me, women of God? Are you hearing me, young people and children of God? Are you hearing that the very word power, dunamis, mentioned here in the book of Acts, is power for performing miracles? It further is defined as power consisting in or resting upon armies, forces, and hosts. Let me read for you again, Acts 4:33. And with great dunamis, and with great power gave the apostles witness. And with great miracle-working power. And with great power residing inside of them by the nature of the one that was now living in them. By great power consisting in or resting upon them as an army of God. As a force for the Holy Ghost in the earth, and as joining the hosts of heaven in impacting our world. The second word out of this verse, witness. The Greek word for witness is marturion. It means a raising up, or I'm sorry, it means evidence or proof of. I'm getting ahead of myself, that's resurrection. Marturion means evidence or proof of. If there is no evidence in you today that you have resurrection power, then you don't have it. But that's okay, because it's available today. Don't lose hope. Today is a day of hope. I pray that everybody today, the first breath that you took, hope filled your lungs. Not COVID-19, but hope filled your lungs. And to all those out there that are struggling in hospital rooms right now, in intensive care units right now, that have contracted this disease or this illness, this virus called COVID-19, I say in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ that God's healing virtue is reaching you even now as I am praying, and you will raise up just as Jesus did. Your life's not over yet. You're coming out of that hospital room. You're coming out of that sickness in the name of Jesus. Evidence or proof of. What proof do we have? What proof do we have? The word witness. Can you imagine being there, walking into that tomb, and he's not there, but there's an angel there, and that angel is telling you that he died. He was crucified. And this is where they laid his body. But come take a look, because he's not here. He's not here. To be an eyewitness of that, to be able to see that and go out. Imagine the story that they begin to tell people. And you know, some people, as soon as you begin to tell them, say, hey, I was just at the tomb early this morning and he's not there. I walked in there. I didn't just stay on the outside. And they'll say, well, what about the big stone that was in front? It's gone. It rolled aside. And don't forget, please don't forget, that the Pharisees, the religious rulers of that day, had gone to Pilate and said, hey, we're afraid that his disciples are going to steal his body in the night, and they're going to start a rumor that he has risen from the dead, because that's what he said he would do. I'm telling you right now that the Pharisees had more faith that Jesus Christ was going to do what he said he would do than Jesus' own disciples had faith for. God help us to have faith for what we profess. God help us to have faith for what we know God will do and shall do. God help us to have faith. And with great power gave the apostles witness. See, there's a difference between just witnessing about something and then having power to witness about something. There's a huge difference between you and I being able to just get up and say, oh yeah, I can be a witness to that. I can testify about that. But it doesn't connect with anything, and there's no real power behind it. But everything changes, friend, when you have got this dunamis behind it. When you're not just a witness of something that you saw with your natural eye, but there's something living inside of you. There's something down deep inside of you. There's something inside of you that comes directly from God himself. That dunamis gives you the power to be a witness of the resurrection. The third word in this verse, the Greek word for resurrection, is anastasis or anastasis. A raising up, a rising from the dead, and raised to life. Raised to life. We celebrate the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ every day. We don't wait for that one day a year that it happens to be on the calendar, and I thank God that it's on the calendar. But listen, friend, if that's the only time that you celebrate the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ, you are missing out. You are missing out on everything that God has for you. Celebrate it every day. When you get up tomorrow, celebrate the resurrection of Jesus Christ. When you wake up next month, next year, if the Lord gives you the mercy to do so, praise him and thank him for resurrecting himself on our behalf. A raising up, a rising from the dead, raised to life. Well, I tell you what, there were people that didn't really believe in him. They didn't believe in him with all of their hearts before his resurrection. But all of a sudden, the Lord starts to move about. This resurrected one begins to show up and make appearances. He's walking on the road to Emmaus with some of them. They all of a sudden, really, after he left them, did our hearts not burn within us? That was him. Everything changed in their world that day. Faith went to a new level. And I know right now our faith is being challenged like it has never been challenged, not in any of our lifetimes. But I got news for the God of this world. I got news for the spirit of fear that is standing on the side of the hill like Goliath of old and bellowing out and trying to intimidate and trying to defy the armies of God. I got news for you. You're not defeating us. You're not causing us to back up and back down and to quit. You know what you've done, fear? You have forced the body of Christ back on its knees.
Romans 6 says this: for if we have been planted together in the likeness of his death, we shall be also in the likeness of his resurrection. Woo! We shall be also in the likeness of his resurrection. See, friend, when you repented of your sins and you accepted Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, the Bible said that he stands at the door and he knocks. If anybody will open up that door, he said, I'll come in. So the day that you accepted Christ, you opened the door and you said, Jesus, you can come into my life. Thank God for that day. But let me tell you something. That was just step number one. Listen to this preacher today when I tell you it was just step number one. Because Romans 6:5 says that you haven't only been planted in his death, but you've got to also be planted into the likeness of his resurrection. God has planted a seed called repentance in your life. And that seed is birthing something in you and growing something in you that has got to come out. And what is planted inside of you is going to come out in resurrection power. They buried Jesus. Let me tell you something, friend. He was coming out. When he died on Calvary, that was repentance. That was Jesus taking all the sins of every human being that has ever lived, that was alive then, or ever would live, and putting it on himself. Only God could do that, robing himself in flesh so that he could actually shed blood. He takes all the sins of the world. That's repentance. But see, that wasn't the end of it. That was just step number one. And after he died on that cross, 9 hours of hanging there, they take him and they bury him in a tomb. They put that stone in front of it, and then they ask for the Roman guard to come and watch over and put the great seal of Caesar on it. Nobody's going to mess with it. Oh, little did they know that it wasn't a human being coming to mess with it, but it was the angel of God. I remember one man singing back in the day, a Christian guy, he was singing the song, and part of it is kind of like a story, and he said that the angel Gabriel stepped inside and said, hey, I'm Gabriel, who are you? Bible said that those Roman soldiers fell like dead men. A greater power had showed up. And a greater power is here today. Fear is not the greatest power. This spirit of intimidation that's going around right now and people are wondering what's going to happen, that's not the greatest spirit here. The greater spirit is here, and that spirit is the Lord Jesus Christ. If you've repented of your sins, you've taken that first step. And I applaud you for that, and I thank God for it. I sincerely thank God for it. But God's not finished with you yet. You have to go on, because when he was buried, because that's what you do when something dies, you bury it. And so just like when he died, they buried him. When you and I die to sin, we've got to be buried. Thank God we don't have to get buried in the dirt. We get buried in a watery grave of baptism. And when we come up out of that water, the Bible said we are a new creation in Christ. Brand new. We get to start over. Everything in our past is gone. A new lease on life. You can't beat that. His name. When you're baptized in his name, you've been planted together with him in his death. But you can't stop there, because he didn't stop there. He got up. And so can you. Why would any of us want to live without resurrection power? There's a trumpet that's going to sound one day. The Bible said that the dead in Christ are going to rise first. Can you imagine a trumpet that actually can be heard by those that are physically dead? Come on, friend. And then the Bible says that we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be. You know what you have to be able to get up out of this place? You got to have the same spirit that raised up Christ Jesus from the dead. You got to have it in you. Jesus said in John 11:25, this is what he said to her. This was Mary and Martha. He said, I am the resurrection. I am the resurrection. I don't just resurrect things. I don't just orchestrate resurrections. That's not just a part of my job description. It's a part of who I am. It's part of my identity. He told him, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. Acts chapter 2 and verse number 1. I'm going to try to bring some hope to you today, into a place that perhaps you're not familiar with, but by the time we get done with this message, you're going to be familiar with. And I'm almost done. I am almost finished. Acts 2 and 1 says this, and when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place, and suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting.
And there appeared unto them cloven tongues, like as a fire, and it sat upon each of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost, and began to speak with other tongues, as the Spirit. That same Spirit that raised up that dead body after 3 days gave these 120 believers, gave them the ability to speak in heaven's language. Resurrection power. Resurrection power. Listen to Romans 8 and 11. Does the Spirit of the one who brought Jesus back to life live in you? This is Romans 8, chapter 8, verse 11. I'm reading out of the God's Word translation. Does the Spirit of the one who brought Jesus back to life live in you? It's a question. So I'm asking you that question today. Does the Spirit of the one who brought the dead body, Jesus, back to life, live in you? Remember, the Bible said that in the body, in Jesus, dwelt the fullness of the Godhead bodily. That same Spirit that was inside of that body that Mary produced came back into that body after 3 days. And now the question in Romans 8, 11 is this, is does the Spirit of the one who brought Jesus back to life live in you? Then, it goes on to say, then the one who brought Christ back to life will also make your mortal bodies alive by his Spirit who lives in you. You got to have the Holy Ghost. Today is the day of salvation. Jesus did not just come to die for our sins. That's why we have Easter, y'all. He didn't just come to die. If all he did was come to die for sins, there would be no Easter. There would be no resurrection. But what is Calvary without resurrection? What good is Calvary without overcoming of death? What good is Calvary if Jesus is still in his tomb somewhere? You know, there's a lot of other people that call themselves God that are still in their tomb today. There's a lot of other graves that are still filled with the bones of those that claim to be God and claim to be just like Jesus Christ. But there's an empty tomb over in Jerusalem that has been empty for 2,000 years, and it will remain empty because he's alive forevermore. He's alive. The question is, does he live inside of you? Huh? Not just a casual relationship, not just he came in, you opened the door and he came in, thank God for it, but beyond that, not just, oh, I saw some miracles and I was an eyewitness, I was there when he did this. There were a lot of people there when he fed the 5,000. There were a lot of people there. Judas was there. Hello. There were a lot of people there. And that's all they had with Jesus, was a very surface relationship. You know, just a casual kind of relationship. The only time that it ever gets serious is when life gets serious. Well, friend, life is serious right now. Resurrection Day 2020 is a serious resurrection day. In your lifetime, in my lifetime, I would have to say that this is the most serious Easter that you and I have ever had. I can just imagine that, you know, every year for Easter, more people come to the church house. It is the biggest attendance across the entire globe, Easter Sunday is. Even Christmas doesn't catch up to Easter. Easter is just head and shoulders above all of the rest of them. But guess what? I guarantee you that today, the numbers, if we could track them down, are staggering. Staggering. They're Italy. I just saw, just a few days ago, I read an article and I saw pictures of people over in Italy. I'm talking about from government officials and prime ministers all the way down to the lowest of low people in the entire country of Italy that are on their faces out in the streets of their cities, and they are praying and saying, God, God, come and rescue us. God, come and deliver us of COVID-19. God, come. Come, you're our God. We turn back to you. We give ourselves back to you. What about us, America? What about us, North Myrtle Beach? What about us, Powerhouse Church? Have we fallen on our faces? Has it gotten serious enough that we have fallen broken before him, pledging, committing to God and saying,
I will never go back to the way I was before this virus hit. I will never go back to the way things were. I'm praying more now than I've ever prayed. I'm fasting more now than I've ever fasted. I'm reading the Word of God more now than I've ever read the Word of God. I've joined a Bible study right now. I'm watching services. I haven't been to church in 10 years, 15 years, 20 years, 30 years. I've never been to church, but I'm going now. I'm watching online. Why? Because life has gotten too big. It's out of control. I need help. I need hope. I just realized that I'm not in control. Let me end with this. There's coming a final resurrection. I mentioned it a little bit earlier about the trumpet that's going to sound. But I'm going to finish in the last book, the final book of the entire Bible, the book of Revelation. It's not quite the last chapter, but very close to the last chapter, chapter 20 and verse number 6. This is what it says. The final resurrection is described in this final book of the Bible like this. One verse, verse 6. Blessed and holy is he or she that hath part in the first resurrection. Now remember that Jesus told Mary and Martha and all the rest of us that have the benefit of reading a Bible, I am the resurrection and the life. Now think about this. Blessed and holy is he that hath part in the first resurrection. On such, who? On who? On the blessed and the holy that hath part. So you got to go do whatever you got to do. I've got to go do whatever I've got to do to make sure that I'm blessed and I'm holy and I've got a part. Because it says, on such the second death hath no power. You see, friend, you can't stay in repentance, just like Jesus didn't stay on the cross. I see a lot of people with their crosses and they still got that figure of that broken body hanging on that cross. Listen, friend, you don't understand. That was just a physical body that for 33 and a half years lived so that for 9 hours he could hang on a cross and shed his blood. He's not on the cross anymore. Get him off the cross. And if you go to a grave, he's not there anymore either. Now he said, I want to live inside of you. He said, I will be in you and you will be in me. He said, but they, the blessed and the holy, those that have part, shall be priests of God and of Christ, the Messiah, the Lamb, and shall reign with him 1,000 years. Resurrection Day 2020. This is a very fluid situation going on in our world today. So many different people speaking, saying, we've hit our peak. You know, 10 seconds later, somebody coming out saying, no, we won't hit our peak for another 2 weeks. Then others coming out and saying, probably doomsday people, and saying, oh, we won't hit our peak till sometime late in May or maybe even into June. If you're caught right now in the whirlwind of all that stuff that is going on and news about this and news about that, and you're like, who in the world can you believe? Can I please arrest your attention today and bring it to the Lord Jesus Christ? Because he said, listen, he said, I don't change. I'm the same yesterday, today, and forever. At the close of the Old Testament, he said this, I am God, I change not. That's the same God that you and I serve today. What is God doing? People wonder, what is God doing? I'm going to tell you what God is doing. He's standing at the door. And he's knocking. And if you'll let him in, he said he'll come in and he'll sup with you. He'll begin a relationship with you. But catch the word begin. After he comes in and you feel his peace permeate the atmosphere of your life. I mean, fill every nook and cranny. Every crack and crevice of your entire life will be filled with the peace of God. That's what happens when true, heartfelt repentance is made. The Spirit of God comes fresh with you. Follow the one that died for you. Follow him. follow him to the tomb and partake of his burial. If you've never been baptized, in the name of the one who died for you on Calvary, please, I beg of you, reach out. Put a text on this live stream right now. Send a message to Powerhouse Church. Reach out to people that are a part of our congregation. We'll meet you wherever, one-on-one, at the ocean, at the river, at a lake, in your bathtub, in the pool behind your house, and we'll baptize you today in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Then don't stop there. Why would you stop at the tomb? Just like the three ladies that went there, and the angel said, "Why seek you the living among the dead?" Oh, he's moved. He's moved. You got to go find him. Where is he at? He's living in resurrection. This is Resurrection Day 2020. We're living in resurrection. Salvation is available for you today. Go ahead and get that Holy Ghost today. When you pray, I'm getting ready to pray. When I pray, I want you to pray, "God, if your spirit is for me," let's just go ahead and pray. "If your spirit is for me, then I want it. Give me the faith to receive your spirit. I want to go beyond Calvary. I want to go beyond repentance. I want to go beyond the tomb. I want the same spirit that raised up that body on the third day to come inside of me. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, I say it is done. In the name of Jesus." God bless you today. We love you. Happy Easter. Happy Resurrection Day 2020. We give all the glory to God for what he is doing right now in the earth. Don't be afraid. God is in control. The Lord bless you. In Jesus' name.